special guests, please take your seats. The change of command and assumption of command ceremonies will begin momentarily. This is a covered ceremony. All civilians, soldiers, and airmen not in uniform are invited to stand with their right hands placed over their hearts during the singing of the national anthem. Service members in uniform will salute during the national anthem. As a reminder, please take off or place all cell phones on silent during the ceremony. Thank you. Yes. The change of command and assumption of command ceremonies will continue to begin momentarily. As a reminder, this is a covered ceremony. All civilians, soldiers, and airmen not in uniform are invited to stand with their right hands placed over their hearts during the singing of the national anthem. Service members in uniform will salute during the national anthem. As a reminder, please turn off or place all cell phones on silent during the ceremony. And thank you for your patience. My pleasure to welcome you to today's historic change of command for the 31st Adjutant General of Maryland. Assumption of command for the Assistant Adjutant General, Maryland Air National Guard, and the Assumption of command for the Assistant Adjutant General, Maryland Army National Guard. I ask that all military members in formation remain covered during this event, and military and civilian guests remain covered during the ceremony. Please stand for the arrival of the official party being escorted by Lieutenant Colonel Petrie. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, soldiers, airmen, civilians, and volunteers of the Maryland Military Department of the Maryland National Guard. Welcome to today's ceremonies. Today, the Adjutant General of Maryland, Major General Timothy E. Gowen, will relinquish command to Major General Janine L. Burkhead. Brigadier General Drew E. Dougherty will assume command as the Assistant Adjutant General, Air National Guard, and Colonel Andrew W. Collins will assume command as the Assistant Adjutant General, Army National Guard. These traditional events, rich with symbolism and heritage, will begin with an inspection of troops, followed by the traditional change of command and assumption of commands, and end with a pass-in review. The official party for today's ceremonies consists of Governor Wes Moore, the 63rd Governor of Maryland, outgoing Adjutant General, Major General Timothy E. Gowen, incoming Adjutant General, Major General Janine L. Burkhead, incoming Assistant Adjutant General, Air National Guard, Brigadier General Drew E. Dougherty, and incoming Assistant Adjutant General, Army National Guard, Colonel Andrew W. Collins. We would like to welcome our distinguished guests today. Members of the Maryland's Congressional Delegation, the Honorable Adrian A. Jones, Maryland Speaker of the House of Delegates, the Honorable Boyd K. Rutherford, 9th Lieutenant Governor of Maryland, members of the Maryland State Senate, members of the Maryland House of Delegates, elected and appointed public officials from across the state of Maryland, and members of Governor Moore's cabinet and his special staff, welcome. A warm welcome is extended to all former commanders and sergeants major, many of whom are with us today. Their dedication and leadership formed the Maryland National Guard into the professional organization it is today. Finally, a very special thank you is extended to the family members of our military service members and volunteers. Without your love and support, our service would not be possible. Please stand for the invocation by Chaplain Brigadier General William Green, Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen, please bow with me. Almighty God, we give thanks to you for all things, for the continued blessings of life, and for how you constantly watch over your people. On this day, we honor you and give thanks for the Maryland National Guard and the Military Department. We are grateful for the exceptional service rendered by Major General Gowen, Brigadier General Jones, and Major General Burkhead in the positions of leadership they relinquish today. And, oh God, we are thankful for how you have prepared Major General Burkhead, Brigadier General Dougherty, and Colonel Collins to excel in their new positions as the lead of the Maryland Military Department into the future. Lord, the task before these leaders is great. May each of them continue to grow in courage, model selfless service, and never hesitate to do the hard things. Endow them with unrelenting strength to meet the challenges and the demands ahead as they develop and sustain their team in its readiness to serve the people of Maryland and to fight and win every war that threatens our nation's peace and liberty and the freedoms we so enjoy. And now, may the burning flame of freedom and liberty continue to shine forth from Maryland and our nation as a beacon of living hope to freedom-loving people everywhere. In your most holy name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain Green. Please be seated. In keeping with tradition, a bouquet of red roses is presented to Miss Gowan, wife of Major General Gowan, for his love and valued appreciation for her support over the many years of his honorable service. Miss Gowan, may you please stand. A bouquet of red and yellow roses is presented to Mr. Craig Morton, husband of Major General Burkhead. His gift is a representation of her love and acknowledgement of Mr. Morton's support during her time as the Army commander. As she takes command today, the gift also represents the voyage they will travel together in this new chapter of her military service as the 31st Adjutant General of Maryland. Mr. Morton, may you please stand? Ms. Sharon Dougherty, wife of Brigadier General Dougherty, and his daughters Olivia and Abby, will receive yellow roses as a symbol of his acknowledgement for this new profound assignment. May the family of Brigadier General Dougherty please stand. And Dr. Christy Collins, wife of Colonel Collins, and his children, Michael, Abby, Alyssa, and Ellie, will also receive yellow roses as a symbol of his continued gratitude for his military service over the years. May Colonel Collins' family please stand. Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the center of the drill floor. troops formed on the drill floor today are Maryland's Army and Air National Guard's soldiers and airmen, and the Maryland Defense Force. Directly to your front is the Commander of Troops, Colonel Promotable Amy Kremser. To the stage's far left is the 229th Army Band, the Adjutant General's own, under the direction of Drum Major Staff Sergeant Raphael Hemphill and the Commander, Chief Daniel Stinchcomb. To their left is the Maryland Army National Guard, commanded by Colonel Kathleen Smith. To their left is the Maryland Air National Guard, commanded by Colonel Jason Burns. And to their left is the Maryland Defense Force, commanded by Lieutenant Colonel Beringer. In the center of the floor is the Color Guard, under the direction of Command Sergeant Major David Perry. Please rise as the Commander of Troops brings the unit to present arms to honor our hosts and officers on the reviewing stage. Our reviewing officer today is Governor Wes Moore. Please be seated. The Commander of Troops will now prepare for the trooping of the colors. During this time, military members in uniform will stand and render a salute as the colors pass. Upon the colors passing, please sit down. Ceremony of Trooping the Colors is intended to honor the proud history of the Maryland National Guard. At one time, this ceremony, originated by the British Army, provided a rallying point and a morale boost for the troops who witnessed it. In today's ceremony, the Honor Guard is carrying the national colors, state colors, the Department of the Army colors, the Department of the Air Force colors, and the Maryland National Guard colors. Commander of Troops, please troop the colors. Thank you. present the Maryland National Guard for inspection. The inspection party consists of the following inspecting officers: Governor Wes Moore, Major General Gowan, and Major General Burkhead. special guests, please rise as the commander of troops will prepare the unit to honor the nation's colors. Mr. Jay Copeland, Season 20, American Idol finalist, will now sing the national anthem.
By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, the change of command ceremony is a military tradition that is rich with symbolism and a heritage that dates to the earliest records of military action. Soldiers often carried staffs or standards into battle that identified them as a unit. Throughout military history, unit colors have marked the position of the commander on the battlefield and served as a rallying point. While attacking or rallying on the battlefield, soldiers would follow the standard or guidons of their leader, most often found at the forward edge of battle. In more recent times, the colors represent not only the heritage and history of the unit, but also the unity and loyalty of its soldiers. The guidon is the commander's symbol of authority, representing his responsibilities to the organization. Wherever the commander is, there also is the colors. The passing of the unit colors represent the transfer of authority for the unit from one commander to another. The custodian of the colors today is Command Sergeant Major David Perry. He is the Army Command Sergeant Major, serves as the senior enlisted soldier in the organization and principal advisor to the commander. The change of command begins as Command Sergeant Major Harry passes the colors to Major General Gowan for the last time. Major General Gowan passes the colors to Governor Moore, thereby relinquishing him of all his previous responsibilities and authority. Governor Moore passes the colors to Major General Burkhead, charging her as the new Adjutant General of Maryland with the same responsibilities and authority. Major General Burkhead. Attention to orders. By the authority of Army Regulation 600-20, paragraph 2-5A, and the Governor of Maryland, Brigadier General Burkhead assumes command of the Maryland National Guard, 9 April 2023, signed Wes Moore, Governor of Maryland. Major General Burkhead will now pass the colors back to Command Sergeant Major Harry. Please be seated. Major General Burkhead and Brigadier General Dougherty will now perform the Assistant Adjutant General Air National Guard Assumption of Command. Command Chief Master Sergeant Bator passes the colors to Major General Burkhead. Major General Burkhead will now pass the colors to Brigadier General Dougherty. Attention to orders. By the authority of Air Force Instruction and the Adjutant General of Maryland, Brigadier General Dougherty assumes command of the Air National Guard, effective 20 April 2023. Brigadier General Dougherty will now pass the colors to Command Chief Master Sergeant Bator. Please be seated. Major General Burkhead and Colonel Collins will now perform the Assistant Adjutant General Army National Guard Assumption of Command. will pass the colors to Major General Burkhead. Major General Burkhead will pass the colors to Colonel Collins. Attention to orders. By the authority of the Army Regulation 600-20, paragraph 2-5 Alpha, and the Adjutant General of Maryland, Colonel Collins assumes command of the Army National Guard, effective 20 April 2023. Colonel Collins will now return the colors back to Command Sergeant Major Metzger. Please be seated. Governor Wes Moore is the 63rd governor of the state of Maryland. He is Maryland's first black governor in the state's 246-year history and is just the third African-American elected governor in the history of the United States. Governor Moore is a proud graduate of Valley Forge Military Academy and College. Upon graduation, he was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the U.S. Army in 1998. Governor Moore earned his bachelor's in international relations and economics at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. And while at Johns Hopkins, he interned in the office of former Baltimore Mayor Kurt Schmoke. Governor Moore was the first black Rhodes Scholar in the history of Johns Hopkins University, and as a Rhodes Scholar, earned a master's degree in international relations from Wolfson College at Oxford. In 2005, Governor Moore deployed to Afghanistan as a captain with the 82nd Airborne Division, leading soldiers in combat. Immediately upon returning home, Moore served as a White House fellow, advising on issues of national security and international relations. As a well-known investment banker, author, television producer, and nonprofit executive, special guest, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the 63rd Governor of Maryland, Wes Moore.
Good afternoon. I am honored and I'm humbled to be here for not just such an important day and such a historic day, but such a powerful day for our state. And at the top of my remarks, I'd like to spend time to recognize the members of the Maryland Congressional Delegation, the members of the Maryland General Assembly, all of our distinguished military leaders, both active duty and retired, our partners all across the great state of Maryland, and the family and friends of Major General Jeanine Burkhead. We are here to engage in the solemn duty of handing over the torch and the authority from Adjutant General Gowan to Adjutant General Burkhead. And I want to first start by giving a sincere and a heartfelt thank you to General Gowan for his service and for his leadership. General Gowan, your leadership is nothing short of stellar. And we are grateful. As a state and as a nation, you have protected our state with distinction in times of promise and also in times of peril. You define what it means to serve, and we are truly grateful for your service, sir. Thank you so much. And your leadership has kept us safe throughout a variety of different circumstances and situations. And so we know that walking in, that General Burkhead has very big shoes to fill. But do not let her size 8s fool you. Because she's ready. And we're grateful. Because General Burkhead is a soldier's soldier. She understands that raising your hand to serve is not about showing off. It's about doing the work. It's about helping others. It's about making sure that our state and our nation are strong, and her record speaks for itself. Commander of the Maryland Army National Guard, Deputy Commanding General for Reserve Affairs at the U.S. Army War College, Senior Advisor for the Department of Interior Bureau of Trust Funds Administration. During the COVID pandemic, General Burkhead made sure that we could get shots in the arms and we could reopen our state. And when democracy itself came under attack on January 6th, General Burkhead ensured that Maryland was the first state to respond to the crisis. You only need to look at her record to know that she's ready. But also, it's important to look at who she surrounds herself with. She has been trained by and she has trained with the best. People like former Adjutant General Linda Singh. People like Major General Gowan and all the preceding Adjutant Generals that have served with General Burkhead. People like Brigadier General Denier, who is with us today. People willing to give their lives for causes that are greater than themselves. You show me someone who surrounds themselves with good people, and I will not just show you a good leader, I'll show you a good product. And General Burkhead proves that theory. As I was going through the process of building out this administration, going over all of our positions that we had to fill, and building an administration that I sincerely believe is the best cabinet and the best administration in this country, I spent countless hours evaluating, analyzing, and meeting with potential candidates for all of the positions within the cabinet. Secretaries of Health, Secretaries of the Environment, Veterans Affairs, Labor, Housing, and Community Development. But the truth is, there is no position that I spent more personal time reviewing and engaging than the position of Adjutant General. Because I knew the importance of this role. I knew this was going to be the person that I would be sitting next to when I had to make some of my toughest choices as the 63rd Governor. I knew this is the person that I would be leaning on when crisis struck. When some of our most complicated situations that we might not even see or understand right now, make it to my desk. I knew this was a person that I would depend on in dark hours. I had to surround myself with the best of the best. And there was no question that's exactly what we did with General Burkhead. General Burkhead is battle-tested, she is proven, and she is ready. Right now. And her life story and her achievements and her character prove that she has and she always will live up to her well-deserved call sign, resilience. General Burkhead, on behalf of the 6.2 million Marylanders in our state, thank you for your service. Thank you for always raising your hand when the nation asked you to. Thank you for your leadership and for showing us what right looks like. Thank you for continuing to commit to a better state. And thank you for your continued willingness to serve. Congratulations, Major General. We're better because of you. Thank you. And God bless you all.
Thank you, Governor Moore, for those inspiring words. Major General Godwin, please stand and move forward with Governor Moore to the center of the stage. Attention to orders. The President of the United States, authorized by Act of Congress on 9 July 1918, has awarded the Army Distinguished Service Medal to Major General Timothy E. Godwin for exceptionally meritorious service to the government and duties of greater responsibility during 36 years of service, culminating as the Adjutant General for Maryland. Throughout his tenure, Major General Timothy Godwin has proven to be a superior leader at all levels of command, successfully leading the Maryland National Guard during some of the most crucial events in recent American history. He continued to develop the organization's force structure so that it became a powerhouse in cyber and military intelligence, and oversaw Maryland's state partnership program with Estonia and Bosnia-Herzegovina, strengthening the United States' posture in global affairs. His remarkable dedication and tireless devotion to mission accomplishment successfully contributed to the overall success of the organization. His extraordinary service has been instrumental in advancing and transforming the Maryland National Guard into a robust, mission-ready asset capable of accomplishing the most demanding mission around the world in support of the national strategy. Major General Godwin's superlative actions are in keeping with the finest traditions in military service and reflect great credit upon himself, the Maryland Army National Guard, and the United States Army. Signed, Christine Werma, Secretary of the Army, 28 April, 2023. Please be seated. Special guests, it is my pleasure to introduce Major General Godwin.
First, I want to go off script and say what an amazing job it is that has been for everyone that did something to do with putting this together. This is obviously my last ceremony and perhaps the most complicated one I've ever been a part of. Governor Moore, I'm sure all that drill and ceremony training that you did back in Valley Forge Military Academy has finally paid off, so congratulations. Governor Moore, Lieutenant Governor Miller, distinguished guests, members of the Maryland National Guard, good afternoon. For starters, I want to say thank you to Janine for welcoming me back to my change of command ceremony. Most of you know I retired on May 1st, so I've been pleasantly retired for a little over a month now, and so far at least, retirement's been good to me. It's been great for my health and welfare. I've been taking care of myself much better. I eat better food. I work out more. I get better sleep. I smoke more weed. Just kidding. I don't smoke weed. I pop those gummies instead. Who gave the retirement guy the microphone? Strangely, though, I'm playing less golf than I did before I retired, so that needs to change or I'm going to go back to work full time. So, real quick, some of you may have noticed the portrait that's of me as you walked in. Lara, Era, where are you at? Here somewhere, our artist, she's probably been there, she is way over there, so the
subject might not be the best, but the artistic craft is awesome. So if you get a chance, stop by, have a look at it. That's going to go up in Record Lounge besides all the other Adjutant General. So thank you. Let's give her a round of applause, please. So the other thing is, today is June 3rd. We're 3 days into hurricane season, and for the last, 9 years or so, I've had an app on my phone that warned me whenever hurricanes were forming out in the Atlantic, and today I got one, and I looked at it and said, that's interesting. Delete. Good luck, Janine. It's been an interesting month since I retired. I started my own part-time consulting business, helping out with business development for companies that would like to offer the products and services to the National Guard. And it's interesting to discover, especially after the critical role that the National Guard has played over the past few years, how even today, how little the defense industry knows about the National Guard. A few weeks back, I was in Washington at the office of one of the major defense contractors that you've probably all heard of, and I was talking about the role of the TAG. I was going on and on about how special and unique the role of the TAGs are, and that there's nothing anywhere else like the TAG in the armed forces, and how TAGs are the center of gravity and key to decisions regarding strategy and the capability of the National Guard. And I stopped, and I looked around the room, and that's when I noticed all the blank stares that I was receiving from everybody. And I said, "You don't know what TAG means, do you?" And the lead guy goes, "Yeah, we're going to ask you that. What is a TAG?" So that's okay. They didn't know what a TAG was. I'm pretty sure there's some people in this room here that don't know what a TAG is, and I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. But don't feel bad, because I was 12 years into my Army career before I learned what a TAG was. And I learned it on my very first drill within the Maryland National Guard. I think it was like June or July of 1998. I got up super early in the morning to drive the 114 miles between Mechanicsville, Maryland and Edgewood, Maryland, where I was assigned to an aviation unit called the MACE. Now that's an acronym, M-A-C-E. It stood for Mobilization AVCRAD Control Element. And AVCRAD was another element, another acronym, which stood for Aviation Classification Repair Activity Depot. So this unit to which I was assigned was a one-off aviation unit that I'd never heard of, whose name was an acronym within an acronym. And it had another name, which was another acronym, called ADMRU, Aviation Depot Maintenance Roundout Unit. So as luck would have it, on my very first drill, it was an aviation safety stand-down day, and all of us aviators walked over to the base theater, and in comes this general officer with all these stars on his shoulders. I mean, he had a lot of stars, a lot. And he gave us this inspiring speech, and we went back to our unit headquarters, and I asked someone, "Who was that general?" And they said, "Well, he's the TAG." I said, "TAG? What's TAG?" And they said, "He's the boss, the commanding general." I said, "Yeah, but what's TAG mean?" And they said, "Oh, it's an acronym. It stands for the Adjutant General." I said, "The Adjutant General? The is in the acronym? What is with the acronyms in this organization?" So between that and the 114-mile drive and the weird aviation unit and all the funny acronyms, I didn't think the National Guard was going to be a good fit for me, and I was probably right, because I only stayed for 25 years. But it's been quite a career in the Maryland National Guard. Being the TAG is the honor of a lifetime, and I'm forever grateful to Governor Hogan, who gave me this awesome opportunity to serve at this level. And as you've probably figured out by now, I didn't set out in the Army to become the Adjutant General of the Maryland National Guard, because if I had, I probably wouldn't have made it to this level. Throughout my career, my mindset has always been to become an expert in my craft, do something above and beyond to improve the overall capabilities, leave the place better than I found it, and most importantly, be a good teammate. And I kept showing up, and I kept getting paid, and I kept getting chosen for new opportunities to be a good teammate. And here's the thing about being chosen for leadership positions in the military. You're not chosen because you're the smartest or most physically fit, or you're the best scout pilot or most handsome, although that helps. No, you're chosen because your leadership sees your potential to lead successfully at the next level. And that's it. So when you get chosen to lead, you get in there, you learn, you make mistakes, you learn from your mistakes, you grow your potential, and you get selected to lead at the next higher level. Rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat. 37 years later, you're retiring as a tag in Maryland. It's that easy. I also can't stress enough the aspect of being a good teammate. The reason I loved being a soldier for 37 years is because I love being a member of a team. And in my opinion, the U.S. Armed Forces are the greatest team in history, period.
That's right.
So when you do get selected to lead, remember this. It's not your team that you're leading, it's the team. So as the leader, you're simply just another member of the team, but it's your job to use your power and authority for the greater good of that team. Empower your subordinates. Give them opportunities for growth, and always remind them of the bigger mission. Use your authority, or what I would call my tag muscles, for the good of the subordinates to help them to grow to meet their potential. And if you do that, your team will stay motivated to serve, and they'll keep showing up, and when you need, when your nation calls, or your state calls, your National Guard will always be ready and always be there. So before I leave the stage one last time, I want to acknowledge this awesome team that is the Maryland National Guard. To the Maryland Military Department, you've come a long way improving the processes, making effective use of taxpayer money and resources. I'll say, though, I personally had very little to do with the progress that you've made. Under Nate Cookie Crumb's leadership and with a lot of help from Adam Flash, a.k.a. Shrek, you've become one of the best departments in the state of Maryland, and I charge you to keep getting better. And speaking of Adam Flash, to the joint staff under Adam's leadership, your capabilities have grown to be a model staff for the entire 54. Amy, you've got big shoes to fill. I'm sure you'll do great. To the Maryland Defense Force, first of all, you guys look great in your OCPs. Your volunteerism is an inspiration to all of us. Thank you for your model citizenry. Greg Jude is not here today, but he's done great things with the MDDF, and he's going to take this awesome organization to the next levels. Congratulations and good luck. To the Maryland Air National Guard, from cyber to close air support, you're the best in the nation. Doc, A-10's forever, baby, or at least till he gives F-35s. Keep after that 8,000 feet of good, useful concrete. To the Maryland Army National Guard, thank you for 25 great years. Drew, remember these three things. Readiness. Jeanine, you're everything Maryland could ever want in a leader. Maryland and the nation. I'll leave you with this. Every tag has their challenge. Might not be another pandemic, or civil unrest, or Snowmageddon, or Superstorm Sandy, but it will be something. And it could be the big one. So if there's ever anything that I can help you with, please just give me a call. And if I'm not playing golf that day, I'll be right there. Governor Moore. Governor Wesley Rotunda Amari Moore. I'm going to get it right this time. Sir, thank you. I think you're terrific. I have great respect for you and your energy and your drive, your imagination, your initiative, and this is coming from a registered Republican. You bring an energy that our state and our country desperately needs, and I look forward to seeing you succeed magnificently over the next 7 years and ever beyond. To everyone in the entire Maryland National Guard, thank you for your support and respect. I'm so proud of you. And just one last time for Chewy, he's out there somewhere. Questions? Comments, alibis, nothing heard. Hold line.
Thank you, Major General Gowen. Special guest, the 31st Adjutant General of Maryland, Major General Jeanine L. Burkhead.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. What a wonderful day. What a wonderful day. Thank you, team, for making this such a special day. I think we've shown Maryland and our new governor what we're capable of and what we do. Governor Moore, elected officials, cabinet secretaries, general officers, partners, distinguished guests, fellow guardsmen, airmen, civilians, friends, family, and everybody. Welcome. The Maryland National Guard has a rich and proud tradition of service since 1634. One of those hallowed traditions is this change of command. Governor Moore, thank you for having the confidence to select me as your 31st Adjutant General. I won't let you down. To General Gowan, Godspeed and best wishes on the golf course. I do not take this charge lightly. I will use the breadth and depth of my experience to do the best for you, to ensure readiness, 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 and to ensure that we have a flying mission. My journey to this position is not a tribute to my accomplishments, but to the leaders and the soldiers that you see before you today, and the family members, friends, and mentors who have helped me along the way. Now, it's a historic event to have another Adjutant General, only the 31st, and I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize, again, Lieutenant General Frederick, and I think Linda and Laura are here today. Or, yes? I have to recognize the Frederick girls. General Frederick was such a big part of this 5th Regiment Armory in the Maryland National Guard. I will remember my commitment to not only the soldiers and the service members, but also the civilians who are part of this military department. General Gowan spoke of the fabulous work that we've done in the past, and I look forward to working as a full team without silos to ensure we take care of our state and nation. I take charge as the 31st Adjutant General humbly and eagerly, and this is Resilient 6, ready to serve.
Thank you, Major General Burkhead. Special guests, the Assistant Adjutant General, Air National Guard, Brigadier General Doherty.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to start, thank you, Governor Moore. I can't tell you what an honor it is to be standing here today. You know, I've been fortunate to be part of the Maryland Air National Guard for the last 15 years, and the opportunity to command this tremendous organization is truly a blessing and a special privilege. Major General Burkhead, I certainly appreciate your trust and vote of confidence in giving me this opportunity. I know how much you care about our soldiers and airmen, and how you work tirelessly for our great state, for the Maryland National Guard, and for the Maryland Military Department. I commit to you to lead this organization as best I know how. Major General Gowan, thank you for your steadfast leadership and support of the airmen as the former TAG. Congrats on your retirement, and I think I'll skip the golf handicap joke here. I think we've got that. So, Colonel Collins, congrats on your selection. I'm excited to work with you and build upon the solid foundation and relationship that currently exists between Army and Air. To my friend and former ATAG, retired Brigadier General Jones, I'm happy you were able to make it today, and you are doing well. I know this organization is in great shape thanks to your dedicated I would say I've got it and not to worry, but I don't know if that'll keep the future texts and phone calls away, so I'll just tell you I'll do my best not to mess it up. I'm lucky to have my parents here with me today, and I never want to miss the chance to thank them for always being present, being patient, and being proud of their son. That never gets old. To my daughters, Olivia and Abby, who always make me appreciate the value of time and serve as a beautiful reminder that I will never get that back. So I'll do my best to always say yes when you ask for my time. But I should probably clarify that that doesn't mean your dad is always going to say yes, so in case there's any selective hearing going on. To my wife, Sharon, the journey continues with you by my side as it should. I wouldn't want to go through this with anyone else. Thank you for all your sacrifices and support along the way. Now I'd like to address the men and women of the Maryland Air National Guard. Your outstanding work in support of state and federal missions has solidified our standing as a benchmark for success in the Air National Guard. As we sit here today, we have Maryland A-10s ready to depart for Estonia, then Germany in support of Air Defender. We have cyber operators mobilized against near-peer adversaries. And we have airmen who have just recently returned from six-month deployments around the globe. Our impacts and our reputation are world-class and far-reaching for Maryland and for our country. As we look to the future and the inevitable change that awaits, we draw solace knowing that over the past 102 years of our history, it has been filled with change. My promise to you is we'll meet that change head-on with a strategic vision and intent, continuing to deliver airmen and missions that will help lead our Air Force, delivering exceptional results for the great state of Maryland and for our nation. Thank you all, and God bless.
Thank you, Brigadier General Dougherty. Special guests, finally, the Assistant Adjutant General, Army National Guard, Colonel Collins.
Good afternoon. There's nothing like the pleasure of being on the stage with Maryland's most inspirational leaders, but also what a pain it is to try to follow them in comments. Governor Moore, General Gowan, General Burkhead, General Dougherty, distinguished guests, soldiers, airmen of the Maryland National Guard, Defense Force, thank you all for being here today. I stand before you humbled and determined, inspired and dedicated, proud and ready. But first, I must recognize my source of strength for all the adjectives I just mentioned. My family, Michael, Abby, Alyssa, Ellie, and my wife, Christy. I'm not going to repeat all the things that you've heard me say in the past. Today may be muscle memory for you, but I know that muscle memory doesn't come without acid buildup in your muscle fibers after numerous reps and sets over many years of my military service. I know that many times over the years you didn't want to go to the gym, but you came and pumped iron with me anyway, and because of that, you are the epitome of Army Strong, and I love you all so much. Thank you. Governor Moore, airborne. If you know, you know. You see, once, not too long ago, Governor Moore and I found out that our military alma mater was the 82nd Airborne Division. And airborne is how we've been communicating every time we've ran into each other. Because you see, airborne is not only a question, it's an answer and motivation all rolled into one. Airborne? Sir, I just want to thank you for the opportunity to continue serving this great state, and we will be there when you call. Major General Gowan, congratulations on your retirement and nearly 40 years of service and leadership to our great state and nation. General Burkhead, I want to thank you for your faith and my ability to lead the Maryland Army National Guard. I will continue to carry your torch. And I will continue to carry this torch not only because you asked me to and I believe in it, also because you're probably going to need the additional spare time for all the A-10 request flyovers from General Dougherty. So, yeah. So for many of us, service equals personal fulfillment, and I personally love putting on the green uniform, getting my boots muddy with soldiers, and ensuring our state and nation are ready to prevail against any threat. The post 9/11 era over the past two decades had given many of us the chance to experience that fulfillment. We've worked tirelessly in the face of adversity, and we've emerged victorious time and time again. Just this past week, many citizens recognized the service of our fallen brothers and sisters in arms on Memorial Day. But I know for many of us, that remembrance is on our minds every day. It is a testament to their sacrifice and recognition that our work is not done. Governor Moore's Leave No One Behind is the stone upon which all others break, but it is not fortuitous. His words resonate not only the impression that military service had on him, but are the creeds that are embedded in the Army's culture of service: warrior ethos, soldier's creed, and the ranger creed. We will live up to that. The mission of the Maryland Army National Guard is clear: to provide a relevant and capable force ready to fight, protect, defend, and prevail against all threats at home and abroad. We will provide a force of relevance, responsiveness, and resiliency using an approach that considers people first, readiness, modernization, partnerships, and accountability. To the soldiers of the Maryland Army National Guard, at the end of the day, it's our teamwork, our unity, and our unwavering commitment to one another that truly sets us apart. I truly look forward to not only serving this great state and nation, but to serve you. You always have and always will be my number one priority. Finally, I also wanted to mention there is one other reason it is good to speak last. It's because I get to close, much like the winner does at every Army and Air Force football game, the Army sings second. Go Army, beat Air Force. Leaders up front, Chesapeake 6 out.
Thank you, Colonel Collins. This concludes the change of command for the Adjutant General of Maryland and assumption of command for the Assistant Adjutant Generals. Please rise as the Commander of Troops will now prepare the Maryland National Guard and Maryland Defense Force to pass in review. This concludes today's ceremonies. Please remain standing for the departure of the official party, escorted by Lieutenant Colonel Petrie. Upon their departure of the stage, each honoree will post at their designated flag for photos in the back of the drill floor. Please enjoy the reception in Schaefer Dining Room on the fourth floor. Drive safely, and thank you for attending.